Welcome to another episode of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacierized boulders that were ejected by one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet. This presentation discusses the Nebraska rainwater basins that have the same elliptical geomorphology as the Carolina Bays, but which are located at an elevation of about 516 meters above sea level. These basins are used as wildlife management areas. South-central Nebraska is predominantly a large plain of fluvial sands and gravels deposited on the southern side of the Platte River. All the terrain is covered by several meters of loess, which is a loosely compacted deposit of windblown dust. The area has many shallow lakes, marshes, and other wetlands known as the rainwater basin wetlands. This LiDAR image with a colorized topography shows the elliptical geomorphology of the Nebraska rainwater basins. A satellite image of the same area shows just a few lakes, but it does not show the elliptical basins. In the spring and fall months, millions of migratory birds pass through these wetlands to feed and rest. The birds eat the seeds of wild plants and grains from surrounding farms on their way to or from their nesting grounds. The three wetlands identified here are managed by federal and state agencies with funds obtained from hunting permits. The largest of these three wetlands is the Hansen Waterfowl Production Area in Clay County. Ducks Unlimited has completed the wetland restoration project on the 640-acre Hansen Waterfowl Production Area in Clay County, Nebraska. This project is one of the largest efforts undertaken by DU in the Rainwater Basin. DU's work on this project included filling several water concentration pits and installing a pipeline to supply water for managed wetland habitat. DU also plugged two drainage ditches to restore a second large wetland on the tract. This project was launched several years ago when DU acquired the 320-acre property adjoining the Hansen WPA. The land was eventually transferred to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service as an addition to the WPA. DU then removed the mile-long levee separating the two properties. The Hansen WPA project will provide outstanding migration habitat for waterfowl and will be open to the public for hunting and other forms of outdoor recreation. DU is planning a formal project dedication on this site in March. The Nebraska Environmental Trust and the North American Wetlands Conservation Council contributed significant funding to this effort. All the LiDAR images in this presentation are obtained using the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davies. There is a link to this tool in the description of the video. The topography is enhanced by a color spectrum that repeats every 10 meters of elevation and has a different color for each meter. The Nebraska rainwater basins were discovered in the 1990s using digital orthophoto quadrangles, a technology that preceded LiDAR. Notice that all these basins are oriented in a northeast to southwest direction. This is a LiDAR image of Carolina Bays near Fayetteville, North Carolina. Notice that they are all oriented from the northwest to the southeast, almost perpendicular to the orientation of the Nebraska rainwater basins. In order to verify the ellipticity of the Hansen Waterfowl Production Basin, we obtained the latitude and longitude of points along the perimeter of the basin at the red-pink transition zone of the colorized topography as shown in the inset. This ensures that all the sample points are at the same elevation. Using a Python program, we fit an ellipse to the points using a least squares method. A link to this program is given in the description of this video. Notice that no points are selected in the northeast portion of the basin where there is a distortion caused by a drainage channel. All the points fit precisely along the ellipse. The program calculates that the major axis measures 2,311 meters, the minor axis measures 1,673 meters, and the azimuth is 244.5 degrees. Extending the azimuth as a great circle trajectory, we find that the distance of the basin from Lake Michigan is 973 kilometers. Lake Michigan is the convergence point of many Nebraska rainwater basins and Carolina Bays, but there are also some intersections at Saginaw Bay. The elliptical shape of these basins and the convergence of their major axes by the Great Lakes are interesting facts, but what do they mean? It is time to make some logical deductions. Logical deductions are used all the time in science. A logical deduction is a conclusion that can be reached about something because of other things that we know to be true. For example, the coverage of glaciers that are now gone is deduced from the stony moraines that they left behind when the ice melted. Not every pile of rocks is a moraine, so geologists need to be careful about identifying them. This image shows a shadow of a human figure. We can deduce that there was a person standing nearby at the time that the picture was taken, because shadows are made when objects block the light of the sun. But wait, it could be the shadow of a human vampire. Wrong. The picture was taken in the daytime, and everybody knows that vampires only come out at night. A logical deduction can only be reached from things that we know to be true. None of the myths about human vampires are true. It is very frustrating when someone suggests that the Carolina Bays were created by a micronova explosion, by electric discharges of the electric universe, and by other untestable conjectures. Suppose that we wanted to test the hypothesis that a micronova explosion created the Carolina Bays. How would we find a micronova? How would we prove that the Carolina Bays could be created by a micronova explosion? This is an untestable hypothesis. Suppose that we wanted to test the hypothesis that electric discharges created the Carolina Bays. There is no evidence that electrical discharges can produce elliptical basins of 1 kilometer aligned toward the Great Lakes. Electrical discharges have not been shown to create elliptical craters at all. Many Thunderbolt videos claim that the electrical discharges between planets created the craters in Mars. This is not only bad science, it is pure fiction. Such assertions cannot be tested. Don't let smoke and mirrors confuse you. Please remember that if a hypothesis cannot be tested, it is not a scientific hypothesis. In science, we make some observations and propose a hypothesis that fits all the facts by a process of logical deduction. We know that the Carolina Bays and Nebraska Rainwater Basins have a convergence point by the Great Lakes. Previous studies have shown that the bays don't have extraterrestrial or extraneous mineral material, so we can deduce that something from the Great Lakes, like glacier ice, made the basins. Another fact is that the Carolina Bays and Nebraska Rainwater Basins have elliptical geomorphology, as we have shown by fitting them with ellipses. Ellipses are conic sections, therefore, it is logical to propose that the basins originated as inclined conical cavities. Finally, we can demonstrate experimentally that oblique impacts by ice projectiles on a viscous medium produce inclined penetration funnels that are elliptical when viewed from above. So the experiments support the impact hypothesis. The Glacier Ice Impact Hypothesis, published in 2017, put together all these facts and proposes that one or more extraterrestrial impacts on the Laurentide ice sheet by the Great Lakes ejected pieces of ice in ballistic trajectories. The secondary impacts produce seismic vibrations that liquefied unconsolidated soil, and the oblique impacts of glacier ice created inclined conical cavities that became shallow elliptical basins by viscous relaxation. Ballistic equations and yield loss correlating projectile size to crater diameter can be used to quantify the formation of the impact basins. The Hansen Waterfowl Production Area in Clay County, Nebraska, is located 973 kilometers from Lake Michigan, which is assumed to be the point from which the glacier ice chunk that made this basin was launched. The basin has a width of 1,673 meters and a length of 2,311 meters. The width-to-length ratio corresponds to an impact angle of 46.4 degrees. The diameter of the glacier ice projectile that made the basin is estimated to be 462 meters, which is one-fifth of the basin length. The ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made this basin was launched at a speed of 3.091 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 7.61 minutes and reached a height of 255 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital spaceflight in the vacuum of space. The kinetic energy of the impact that made this Nebraska rainwater basin was equivalent to 54 megatons of TNT, which would have caused seismic vibrations of magnitude 8.64. Any hypothesis about the origin of the Carolina Bays must also include the origin of the Nebraska rainwater basins. Thus far, all publications proposing that the Carolina Bays were created by wind and water mechanisms have ignored the Nebraska basins, and they have also ignored the mathematically elliptical geometry of well-preserved basins. Fitting ellipses to these basins by the least squares method provides a more quantitative way of studying these enigmatic structures. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. I will continue to examine the mechanisms that made the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska rainwater basins based on the principles of experimental physics. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.